I took over as chair, not knowing exactly what a chair did, what the responsibilities were. So I had a bit of a learning curve there. What became really evident was that science and medicine had made enough of an inroad into their research and the medicines that they had created enough of an illusion that science and medicine had the whole thing under control. It was no longer the darling disease of Hollywood. It was no longer considered a huge threat to everybody. And so people had become very complacent. Well, it became really evident that one had to make the case for relevancy of HIV research in that world. Because, as we all know, research money, like any seed money, is very hard to come by. And when the economy gets tight, that gets even harder to find. When Elizabeth created the foundation and when she was involved with it, her attitude wasn't why, it was why not. And she would never accept no. She'd say, we're going to get to this level. How are we going to do it? We'll figure it out. And that kind of an attitude where you're willing to kind of jump off the cliff is the core dynamic of creativity, taking chances, being willing to fail. Not everybody has that. Coming from a creative world, I think I was most familiar with that. And so I was saying to the board of the foundation, we need to really make a case for the relevancy of HIV research. Well, how do we do that? Well, Elizabeth had created this thing with called collaborative research. What was it called? It was a discipline, collaborative research, in which they funded for 7-year cycles scientists for projects that the scientists would propose, and then with the proviso that those scientists collaborate. They share their findings with each other. They work together. And that, to that point, was not done, was never done. And then I went to a dinner where we were going to announce the next year's recipients. And I sat with a bunch of the scientists and we were talking. And I asked them, I said, look, do you learn things from HIV/AIDS research that gives you an insight into cancer or any other diseases? And they said, absolutely. I said, is it published? I said, no. And so I started to talk with Phil Pizzo, who's the dean of Stanford Medical School and who was on our board, about doing an idea. Elizabeth had talked about having a hospital where all these families would come. Phil and I started talking about an idea where you would get a bunch of teaching hospitals. Our first group was Boston University, Stanford, UCLA, UCSF, and Bailey. And you get these teaching hospitals that have affiliated hospitals, you know, the universities and hospitals. And you get them to collaborate on pediatric diseases, life-threatening pediatric diseases, so that they are sharing their resources. And the second half of the idea, which was really interesting, I thought, was that you also treat diseases as collaborative. In other words, you don't choose a protocol by narrowing your view, but rather widening your view. You say, okay, I want to study this. Okay, now how can I do it that includes possibilities of other issues? How can I increase the amount of questions? Because all the things we learn in this life are accidents. They're all from left field. So you want to create an opportunity for that to happen. So if you think of the disease, the world of disease as collaborative, they collaborate. See how they collaborate. See how they respond, react to each other. And to me, to my way of thinking, it became very clear that if you explain to people that while HIV virus affects the immune system, studying it, doing research on it, is only going to teach you much more about the other things that the immune system has to deal with, not to mention all those things that are going to come down the pike that Mother Nature has prepared on this planet that is getting bigger in population and smaller in resources, where organisms are losing their hosts, you know, species are dying off, and these organisms need to find other places to live, and they're far more malleable and they're far more adaptive than we are. Mm-hmm. And it would be foolish for us to assume that we are going to adapt as well as they do. So we know there's going to be other stuff coming down the turnpike. We just know it. So wouldn't it make sense to use every resource to study as much as we can and hear the HIV virus, instead of being a scourge, instead of being a horrible thing, it becomes a really enormous opportunity to learn. I thought that makes the case.
Absolutely.
Well, any captain of industry that I spoke to got it within seconds. I must have explained it to my board 24 times. Still didn't get it. Because it required raising money when raising money was becoming more and more difficult. So they didn't have the equipment, they didn't have the intellectual ability or the psychological ability to be able to sit with the fear of failure, like Elizabeth sat with the fear of the mortality of herself and her two children, to sit with that fear and choose to do things, to pursue things that seemed unattainable.